But we're in a time when Isaiah 60, verse 1, really must resonate in every heart. Arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. Deep, dense darkness will cover the nations, but the Lord's radiant light will be shining upon you. In this time of deep darkness, in this time of confusion, mayhem, calamity, and all of this, we need to realize we have an anchor that is sure. Our anchor is the Lord Jesus Christ. And let the storms come, we're going to be absolutely stable and steadfast because we're trusting in the Lord. Exodus 14:14 says, be still and watch. The battle's God's, not ours. And God never loses a battle. And I like what Paul said. He said, fight the good fight. Now, I used to street fight. You never get the sap beat out of me and go, wow, that was a good fight. The good fights are the one you win. And God wants you to realize you are already victorious. The Bible says, 1 John 4:4 says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You're more than a conqueror. Romans 8:37 says, yet amid all these things, we're super victorious. And here's one of the things we got to do. Listen, we cannot be lackadaisical. We cannot sit on the sidelines. And I want to just read a little bit about this. I'll just talk to you about it because, listen, here's what he said. He said, it is not a time for passive, non-committed Christianity. It's time for the soldiers to awaken and arise. Every time I get still before the Lord, he says to me, sound the alarm, awake the warriors. And we've got to do that. Isaiah 21:5 says, arise, you princes, and oil the shields. It says, because the deadly foe is at the door. I believe that. I believe there's forces active in our country right now that would erase our country as we know it. There's forces trying to erase everything we know about our Christian heritage. I'm telling you, God wants his church to arise and shine. God wants his people to report for duty. Psalms 110. Psalms 110 verse 3 says, in the day of his power, that would be now, his troops, that would be us, will volunteer freely. Listen, this is not a time to stand on the sideline and go, oh, we're in a mess. This is a time to change the whole course of history. You and I are forging the future our grandchildren will live in. It's very important to realize that we're kings and priests. Think about that now. This is Revelation chapter 1, verses 5 and 6. Unto him, God, that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood and has made us to be priests and kings. Now, a priest, the Bible says a priest can solve and settle controversies. And it says that the word of a king has authoritative power, creative power. And you and I have power in our words. The power of life and death is where? Right here in our words. And we need to start exercising power, kingdom authority. God told me, he said, Bobby, I'm raising me a kingdom company that's going to rule the visible realm from the invisible realm, but they're going to do it through a demeanor of love. Love is powerful, isn't it? Romans 16:20 says, the God of peace will crush Satan under your feet. Isn't that neat? Every time you find Satan and a Christian mentioned New Testament, he's always under your feet. Luke 10:19. Behold, I give you power, authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and it'll in no wise hurt you. I like that, don't you? Well, sure you do. Listen, the Bible tells us that we're unstoppable in Christ. In Christ. Now, without him, we can't do a single thing. Without him, we're weak and we're impotent. But in him, by him, Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through Christ who infuses me with inner strength. I am ready for any task that is at hand. I like that, don't you? I do. In Hebrews 13:20 says, the God of peace that brought again from the dead the Lord Jesus Christ, that by the blood of the everlasting, never-failing covenant, make you perfect, give you everything you need to accomplish the task you're sent to do. You and I have been assigned a magnificent task to shine in these dark days. Esther 4:14 says, we're the kingdom for such a time as this. But guess what? There's something greater than that. What could be greater than being in a kingdom for such a time as this? The kingdom is in you for such a time as this. You were created for these days. You were created to be a victorious warrior. You were created to be the head and not the tail, above only and not beneath. You are absolutely assured in Jesus Christ victory. Remember when Jesus Christ, our elder brother, was hanging from the cross? What did he cry out? It's finished. I am so thankful, beloved. He didn't go, well, I'm finished. He said, it's finished. He used a term that means everything that should have been done is totally done. Nothing's left undone. Aren't you glad of that? I am. I'm glad of that, that God has finished the task. Anything and everything that needed to be done is completely done. See, where's Jesus Christ at right now? Oh, he's seated at the right hand of the Father. No priest ever sat down until all the work was done. Now, I'm telling you, all the work is done. What you and I need to do now, and I'm going really fast, what you and I need to do now is we need to learn how to appropriate, make practical what God has given to us, how to ascertain the weapons of our warfare. And that's what we've got to do. We've got to rise and oil the shield. The first shield I think you and I need to oil is a shield of faith. Have you understood? Faith is absolutely indispensable. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. You say, well, Bobby, wow. And it says, whatever is not of faith is sin. You say, well, Bobby, how can I strengthen my faith? Use what you've got. And we don't have to have mega faith. Faith is a grain of mustard seed. Wow. I'm telling you, all we've got to have is genuine, authentic faith. And we've got to believe that God can do anything. Genesis 18:14. Put this question before us. Is there anything too difficult, too hard, too arduous for the Lord? What's the answer to that? Job 42:2 says, I know anything you set your heart and your hand to do cannot be stopped or stalemated. We were created to have dominion over this earth. You and I, we were created. Genesis 1:26. Let's look at that again. Genesis 1:26. You hear a conversation. A dialogue between God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. Here's what they're saying. Let us make man in our own image, and let's give them kingdom control. Whoa! You and I are destined to take over. You and I are destined to stand up and defeat the works of darkness. Listen, because we really, really are saints, sons, and soldiers. One of the most repetitive names in your Bible for Almighty God is Lord of Armies. That ought to give us a hint that there's a little conflict going on. And I'll tell you what, the closer we get to the end time, the more it's going to escalate. But you and I, in the midst of all this, we throw our hands up, we worship, we rejoice, because we already know the outcome. We know this. They overcame him, the devil, by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death. I'm telling you, you and I, in Jesus Christ, have been created to be victorious, not victims. I've been preaching, good gracious, I've been preaching over 50 years, and I've averaged speaking 5 times a week for 50 years till 2020 came along. But I'm telling you, I want you to know something. God's people are raising up. God's people are looking at the circumstances, the chaos, all the kind of stuff that's happening. And see, I wrote about this. Each year for 26 years, on the Day of Atonement, I have a visitation from Jesus Christ. He'll come tell me some of the things that's going to happen in the future. I write in a book called The Shepherd Drought. This is the Shepherd Drought here for 2020. This is where the Lord said, I want you to teach my people how to soar on the wings of the wind and how to soar above the pandemic, the pandemonium, and the panic and all the things that's happening. In this Shepherd Drought, I prophesied, you can read it, I prophesied about a contagious disease coming. I prophesied about the seas roaring, and I prophesied all of this now. And it did, it came to pass. Epidemics and plagues, all of this is in this Shepherd Drought. You can read it as plain as the nose on your face. If the judgment part came to pass, then the prophetic promise part will come to pass. That's where you need to get into this book, because the Lord said, I love my people far too much to allow them to waste their time tripping over trivial things that really doesn't matter. We're supposed to be dealing Matthew 6:33, but seeking first the kingdom of God, and then all these other things will find their proper place in our life. And so here's what we got to do. He said the pruning has begun. He said there's going to be a shake up or wake up. There's going to be malignant plagues. It's in here. You can just read it as I'll read it for you just a little bit here, just for a moment. This is the Shepherd's Drought for 2020. And God said, I'm creating a shake up to have a wake up. Here's what it says. Prepare for swift shifts and turbulent turns. This shaking and sifting are not to hurt us, but rather to help us. God loves us too much to permit these things cluttering our lives. During this crucial end time period, we do not need to be dealing with trivial things. We must focus on God's higher plan. It's time to rouse to reality. And we use that verse out of Romans. Beside this, you know what a critical hour this is, how that is high time now for us to rise and wake up and get to reality. And it's really important. And we talked about this pandemic. It's right here. I wrote about it. Here's what it says. It says there'll be malignant, contagious diseases and pandemics, and that came. But here's what we got to do now. The end of the prophecy is all the shakeup is to get us to get in alignment with God to experience His greater glory. When all the smoke is cleared, when all the devastation is done, when everything, we're going to find out that we're on a higher plane with God. We're on a deeper dimension with God. We're embracing a greater